I'm John Gardner, and this is my wife, Kathy Weidman. We're very pleased to be a part of this 15th anniversary celebration at the Figge.
John and I have developed a special fondness for the Figge, not only because it nurtures our interest in art, but because it's played a central role in several of our recent important life events. My daughter, Katie, and her husband, Chris, were married in the Figge. Our own wedding reception took place at the Figge and was co-hosted by dear, dear friends that we met here. John and I also met on a Figge-sponsored trip to Spain. I can remember exactly when it happened. It was on the bus to Chicago. Our eyes met. I said, please get me a sandwich, and he said yes, and that was all it took. At any rate, we've made enduring friendships through our participation at events at the Figge, like the gala, and through other opportunities offered, like the Figge Art Lovers Book Club and the Docent Program.
We've been particularly pleased with the collaboration that the Figge does with the various other organizations of the arts in Quad Cities, like the symphony, the ballet, the opera, etc. I think this helps to broaden the materials that are available to the community and makes the Quad Cities a much more exciting, interesting place to live. So welcome to the performance.
Hello. We are thrilled today to welcome my friend and classical pianist, Julian Gargiulo, performing live from Italy. We wish to thank John Gardner and Kathy Weidman for sponsoring this event. Through these uncertain times, the Figge continues to bring art and people together, both on site and through our virtual museum. Throughout the performance, we're going to have a raise the paddle to support our continued mission of bringing art and people together through innovative ways with our community's health and safety in mind. You can make a donation by adding your gift to the Zoom chat room, which is located at the bottom of your screen. It looks a little bit like a message bubble. Or you can go to mightycause.com/donate/Figge, which Sarah has very kindly shared in the chat room. Steinway artist Julian G., commonly referred to as the pianist with the hair because of his distinctive look, is a renowned classical pianist and composer who performs all over the world in prestigious venues from New York's Carnegie Hall to Singapore's Symphony Stage, and has been featured on radio and TV stations in North America, Europe, and Asia. He's beloved by the critics. According to the Huffington Post, expect to revise any preconceived notions you have about classical music concerts. And the Courier Mail says, he's the only classical musician I know who could truly be regarded as a rock star as well. Julian's music and recordings have appeared in movies and documentaries, most recently in the official trailer of Keira Knightley's new film, The Aftermath, produced by Ridley Scott. You can find more info about Julian at his website, which is www.pianistwiththehair.com, and Sarah will post that in the chat as well, or also on his YouTube channel, where you can subscribe for free. And on a personal note, Julian and I have known each other for more than a decade, having first met at a museum function in New York City. We're brainstorming about ways to bring him out to the Figge post-COVID, but in the meantime, we're lucky enough to have him join us from Italy. Please welcome Julian. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is very, very exciting to be here with you virtually. I am, where am I actually? I've been traveling a lot lately, so I'm not quite sure. I'm in Italy at the moment, and you guys are in Davenport, Iowa, I believe, or perhaps you're joining from anywhere in the world. I'm in my childhood home. I grew up here, and I'm playing on the Steinway piano that I can show it to you a little bit. I grew up playing this piano when I was little. It has a lot of trauma related to it. But growing up in Italy, quite stressful, you know, with all the espressos that they make you drink. But it's very, very exciting to be with you today. I started out, in fact, with a piece of Schumann called Kindersenen, which is Scenes from Childhood. And then I continued with a piece of Chopin, one of his etudes, a revolutionary etude. I thought, you know, that might wake us all up a bit. So here it's 7 p.m. and there I think it is noon. Now I'm going to continue with something that I transcribed from the tango repertoire. And I know that we probably shouldn't be dancing the tango, what with all the social distancing and all. So it's a bit weird, I realize that. But this is a tango, so I'm not encouraging you to dance. Normally at a regular show, I would be encouraging my audience to dance. So this is an Argentinian composer who, he grew up in the lower east side of New York, I believe, or it was Greenwich Village. So his name is Astor Piazzolla. And this is a piece that I guess sums up very nicely 2020. It's called Oblivion. Mm-hmm. So you have no idea, as a musician, how weird it is to finish a piece and then hear silence. So I'm led to believe that there are people out there listening. My parents are here in the living room with me, so at least that's better than nothing, though they've chosen also not to applaud, which is frankly a bit offensive, but I won't blame them for that. Also because when you hear two people clapping, it almost sounds worse than hearing a lot of people clapping. But we could practice all clapping together in the house. Each one of you clap together, perhaps we'll hear it. One, two, three, go crazy! Okay, I still didn't hear anything. Oh, somebody from Catherine Weidman wrote clap, clap, clap. So yes, now we are here at the Figge because we're trying to raise some money. And it's great to perform a charity concert, I find. I do it a lot. And it's fun because you get to do something that you love to do and people can then be inspired to donate. I believe that we're, you know, the goal today is to raise, what was it, $50 million, I believe? But you know, I'm sure that we're going to do much better than that. And I believe that there is a screen on the side where you can just, somebody wrote, still clapping, very sweet, where you can just go and donate and there's a link. And so you should absolutely donate to the Figge Museum, which I don't personally know, but I am going to get to know it because Michelle and I definitely need to reconnect and she's the main person there. She never invited me. Perhaps not a good moment to bring that up, but Michelle. So we're gonna continue here. Now, so that piece was a piece from the tango repertoire. Maybe it didn't sound so tango-y. It sounded a little bit, you know, more somber and not dance-like. But it's a piece that Piazzolla wrote and I transcribed it for piano. Now this next piece is a piece that I wrote completely from scratch. So, there's a bit of a story. So I live in Paris, France, and I have two kids, but this story is about my daughter, because my wife had asked me to go out to buy the bread, which is very good in Paris. And so I went out and my daughter came with me. She's very little at the time, she was four. And so she came running after daddy. And I think anybody who's a parent can relate to what happened next. So I was out the busy Parisian streets and suddenly I lost track of her completely. She was gone. And it was a very, very distressful, as you can imagine, moment, but everybody who's a parent can relate to. So, you know, I was desperately looking everywhere for Nikita, my daughter. And in fact, you'll hear the piece now, and you'll probably be able to tell me whether you think, by the way it ends, whether I found her or not. Because, you know, I knew that if I got back home with just the baguette, you know, in the nougat. So the piece is called Finding Nikita, and yes, I did find her. We can discuss in depth later how and where, but she's not here, to tell you the truth. My wife and the two kids are in Greece at the moment, but they are coming on Monday. You know, I was trying to get them to come a little later, but having kids is very difficult. I think that anybody who has kids would agree. Oh, what a delightful daughter some of you wrote. It's cool that I get to see these comments. Please comment more, because, you know, I don't hear you. I can hear you coughing and sneezing in the audience, which is, you know, part of the fun of any concert. Actually, that is one of the benefits. So I was thinking, so we've had a little bit of classical at the beginning. We had the Schumann and the Chopin. Then we went into the Piazzolla. And then we didn't, so that was a bit tango-y. And then we did the original. Do you want to hear another tango? You want to hear another tango? In Italy, they say chi tace consente, which means who does not respond is trying to tell you yes. So I am going to take that as a yes. So this is a piece that it became very famous, I would say, because it was featured in a movie does anybody remember this movie? It had a blind Al Pacino in the movie. And yes, I hear somebody in the south side of Davenport said, Scent of a Woman, well done. And so this is the tango from Scent of a Woman, and it's where he dances with that young girl. He, of course, is blind, and so it's very, very emotional. And here we go. And by the way, I will finish the piece if you donate big during this piece. Thank you. So that was by Carlos Gardel, a piece called Scent of a Woman. And this again was my piano arrangement, my piano transcription of that piece. And you may have heard the phone ring during the performance. And that was someone who was so anxious to donate money that they tried to call me directly on my cell phone. Actually, not on my cell phone, on my mom's cell phone. So people are giving, and I hope you're one of them. But that is funny that the phone rang, I have to say. It was a bit jolting. The other thing that was jolting, you don't hear it actually so loud now, but the neighbor next door, he was listening to the soccer match shortly before the concert. And I was just thinking, you know, if this goes on during the show, it's gonna be pretty bad. Especially if somebody, you know, scores during the pianissimo. But fortunately, I think he's turned it off. So we are good. Now, I'm thinking that we could continue perhaps with a little bit of Debussy. Should we continue with a little bit of Debussy? Now, I was gonna show you and tell you a little bit about Debussy because he's an interesting character, this Debussy. Now, he's written, of course, a lot of music, but there's one piece I think that many people are very familiar with and love, and my parents like it as well. And it's a piece called, my mom is trying to tell me something, but she's, I don't know what she's trying to donate. My mom is trying to donate. You would like sunglasses. The sun is hitting my mom. I feel it necessary to say that I am in Verona at this time because my mom is not well. So if you guys have, I know that you have the capacity for sending energy. So if you want to send any energy, any positive energy to my mom, please do that now. But I think she has the sun in her eyes is her problem. Anyway, be that as it may, Debussy, a piece that you're all familiar with, I think, is his Clair de Lune. And it's a very, very beautiful piece. And I'm going to play it for you right now. But I just wanted to tell you a little bit about Debussy the man, because perhaps you are not as familiar with Debussy the guy. So he was a very, how shall we say, he was a very young, dashing guy. He was a ladies' man. He loved the ladies. He was a hipster. He was a very. I have a picture of him here. I'm gonna show you. Just I don't know if this is visible to you. So this is Debussy, what can I say? Tastes have changed. So Debussy, the wonderful hipster, and he finally became engaged to a lovely girl. Her name was Gabi, and here I will show you what Gabi looks like. This is Gabi. She was a very, very lovely girl. I don't know if you can see her there well, but they got engaged. And then Gabi had a very clever idea. She decided that she would invite to the engagement party, she would invite her best friend and supermodel, Lily. Now, of course, as soon as Debussy sees Lily, he's like, you know, bye, Gabi, hi, Lily. But Debussy was the kind of guy who's never happy. So after they get married, he and Lily, and a couple of years into the thing, he starts complaining that her level of conversation isn't, you know, up to par. And then he's also complaining that she's not aging well. And here, I'll show you, here they are together. I think he's looking over and I think he's checking her Facebook status or something. But anyway, he's very unhappy, so he leaves. He leaves, he kind of goes out and just doesn't come back, and he texts her. He's like, you know, it's over, Lily. And she's distraught, she's completely distraught. And she goes to Place de la Concorde in Paris to commit suicide with a gun. She shoots herself in the chest and misses. You know, so perhaps Debussy wasn't all wrong about her not being so sharp. Debussy eventually ends up with Emma. And I have a picture of him and Emma here, as of course you knew I would. And here he is with Emma. And see, the thing about Debussy, I think he just wasn't a very happy man. Or maybe he's sitting on something sharp, I'm not sure. But, so I hope I haven't ruined the piece for you. So that was the Clair de Lune, which somebody apparently, Susan, said bravo. Thank you, Susan. Thank you for being so kind. It says, let's see. It says how many participants there are. 143 million. Wow. Yes, I expected 150 million, but you know, Michelle will discuss that later. So it's very exciting. It's very exciting that some of you, you know, broke into your Saturday. Michelle said, you know, if it's a really nice day in Davenport, then it's harder to get people to come to the virtual concert. And so, you know, we all did our rain dance, but I didn't check the weather in Davenport today. Maybe somebody wants to type it out in the chat. Is it sunny or is it raining or is it miserable? The weather in Paris, I would say, is the best way to describe it is miserable. Oh, so Michelle wrote it's sunny and beautiful. So there you have it. Now I think that there are many things to be said at a performance like this, namely that this is truly one of the weirdest experiences. But just not having you all in the room with me, of course, as a performer, it's. You know, for everybody, COVID is just like a really bad thing. As a performer, as a concert pianist, where the model is basically get as many people as possible into a confined space, like pack them in. I don't see that happening very soon. So that's all great. I wanted to play something for you of a composer. His name is Franz Schubert, and I was thinking that I could play this piece for you with a mask on. I don't know if that's a good idea. I don't usually play with a mask on, but I think that it's important to wear masks, and I think that we've finally gotten our heads around this idea. So I'm going to play this with a mask, and we'll see what happens. So this is one of his impromptus, and here we go. Let's see if I stop breathing at any point. For that. I kind of thought I'd do that at the last minute. And what I remembered halfway through is that when you wear the mask, your glasses fog up every time you breathe. So it was a foggy Schubert experience. Schubert died very young, unrelated to the fog, of course. Now I was thinking that that would be the last piece on the program, and I know Michelle is out there somewhere. But I was also thinking that I know we wanted to do a little bit of a Q&A, and so many of you are dying to not hear me talk anymore. So the Q&A might seem counterintuitive, but we're going to do it anyway, because that's how we roll here at the Figge. I thought that to end the program, we would play one final piece, because it's kind of nicer to end with music than to just like hear talking. So if Michelle, if you are out there and would like to unmute yourself, that would be fine. And then we'll do the one more. We'll do the one more at the end.
Thank you, Julian. That was just wonderful. And I think that's great to end on a final piece. So Julian has very kindly agreed to answer questions. And so if you have one for him, please enter it in the chat, and either he will read it himself or I will read it to him. But in the meantime, while you're typing away with your questions, I thought I might just get started with one of my own. I, of course, follow you on Facebook and on YouTube, and I noticed that you started a new series called The One Classical Minute. So can you talk a little bit about that series and how you came up with the idea for it?
So I guess we should backtrack and just think about life as a musician, like as a touring musician, which is what I do for a living during, you know, this coronavirus where you can't move anymore. Suddenly everything changes. And so suddenly everything goes online. And what that means is basically video. So I was thinking that it would be fun, especially because people's attention spans have, just because of the way everything is so fast, I thought, why not have a series called One Classical Minute, and it will be on either a piece or on a composer, and it will all be packed into a minute. And so I was very fortunate because I got funding for the first 10 episodes, for the first 10 minutes. And so we've been shooting those, and we just finished shooting Schubert. There's something very wrong about how that sounds. We finished shooting Schubert, but we're moving forward. And so anybody who wants to take a look at that, we don't really have a website, but if you go to oneclassicalminute.com, you will be redirected to the IRS website where, you know, they take your money and taxes. But it's on Facebook and it's on YouTube. And so that's kind of the thing I'm most excited about now, because I guess anybody that has been fortunate enough to do for a living what they love to do, and then, you know, suddenly that's all gone. I came up with a new place where I can, you know, bother people, which is online. Yes, Michelle. Michelle and I, did we really meet at an event? Because see, in my mind, we had met like on the subway.
That's right. When you saved, you pulled me off the tracks, right?
Yes. I derailed your career. She would have, you know, she would have been the president of the Guggenheim right now. But we did, I think we kept running into each other because you were working at, where is it, Bard or?
I think I was working at Bard at the time that we met. Yep, on the Upper West Side.
On the Upper West Side, and I lived on the Upper West Side, and you know,
mutual friends, small world. Mutual friends and small world.
Yeah. It's crazy. It's fun though.
Well, we're so happy that you've agreed to join us from Italy today. I of course have many questions, but I'm seeing a few questions. From our group, and says one is where and with whom did you study?
Okay, so I, as you can probably hear from the thick Italian accent. I was actually born and raised in Italy, and I was very lucky. So my mom is from New York, and my dad is Italian, and so I grew up speaking both languages from the start. And just sidebar on that, my daughter and my son, so I speak to my kids only in Italian, and my wife, who's Greek, she speaks to the kids only in Greek. You can imagine how happy they are about that. Now, at home, my wife and I we met in New York, so we communicate in English. And then we live in Paris, so the kids go to a French school. So we're saving our money for a good therapist for the kids. But I grew up in Italy, and I did study music in Italy initially at the Music Conservatory in Verona. And then I studied in Rome. And then I went to Russia and studied there. I don't know if many of you know, there's a big piano tradition and also other things tradition, but we'll stick to the piano tradition for now. And then I did come to the States, and I got a master's degree in heart surgery, to support the piano career. Most of us are heart surgery. No, I went to Johns Hopkins, which actually is famous for its medical school, but they have a music conservatory called the Peabody Institute and the Peabody Conservatory. So I studied there. And it says, did you need more information?
I think that's good. John and Randy, are you looking for any further? Oh, yes. Yes, they got the thumbs up in the answer.
They got the thumbs up. Look, this is so interactive, ladies and gentlemen. So interactive.
Do we have any other questions? Let's go back to New York for a moment. You had started a competition.
I've been telling my wife that for the longest time. perhaps not the best moment.
Perhaps not, actually. You'd started a competition for emerging artists called Getting to Carnegie. You share what inspired you to start this program or this competition? And I assume it's on hold for this year, but we'll be back next year.
Yes. So Getting to Carnegie is, as the name of the competition tells you, it's about getting to Carnegie. And Carnegie it's a bit of a metaphor in music for, reaching a level of success and recognition. And so it's a metaphor for, reaching the highest plateau, but also, of course, it's a physical location and it's a concert hall in New York. And so the final round of the competition, the first round is online and people just send in their videos. And the final round takes place at Carnegie Hall. And I write a piece of music. So the competition rotates between violin, cello, and voice. And last January we had voice. And so the four finalists, they either play or sing a composition that I wrote, and it's in four parts, and they're four finalists. And then when they're done, so they play the piece, and that's the world premiere of the piece, so that's kind of cool. The finalists get to play it at Carnegie Hall, so they get to write in their bio, play it at Carnegie Hall. And then at the end of the competition, instead of having like the normal jury of professional musicians that judge you, it's the audience that votes for the winner. So those are the differences with this competition. And we've had some like really, really incredible people winning it and just participating in it. And it's grown. So when I started it, I just had this idea. I was like, oh, that sounds like a cool name. Let me see if the website is available. Available. Okay. And so it was just me. Let me contact the conservatories. And so now instead, this is going to be our seventh year. So now it's all, we have a board and actually we have really incredible people on the board. So we have the Avery Fishers of Avery Fisher Hall. Mm-hmm. They're on the board and we have just a lot of people. And so this year, of course, we can't do it at Carnegie Hall because Carnegie Hall is closed. So we're going to do it at Carnegie Deli, of course. So we're going to do it online, completely online, and then the winner will perform at Carnegie Hall next year when we have the vaccine.
Of course, because we're all keeping...
wait, I'm getting a call. Yes. Okay. Perfect.
We're all set.
Confirmed. So this year, instead that it's all online, that we were trying to grow the competition and make it, you know, because I guess a lot of what I do, because the concerts, as you may have seen, are very interactive. Like I like to talk to the audience, and it's very much like the same way in a concert hall. Really, kind of, you're not missing that much, except, you know, you probably get to eat chips and be in your pajamas in this case. But it's very much like this. I play a little, I talk a little. And so the idea is to make classical music more appealing and fun and relevant to especially everybody, really. But I think the young people nowadays have the idea that classical music is not fun and interactive, and it very often isn't. But I think the music is amazing. And if you present it in a way that is a little more relaxed, then it can all get that way. And so we were trying to reach a wider audience with the competition. And we were lucky to have join our board, the president of the Violin Channel, which is basically the biggest source of classical music news on the internet. And it's pretty big, if you're a classical musician. If you're not a classical musician, you might not know. But I think they have like, you know, 350,000 members. So, but it's great. It's a great platform because these finalists now, you know, Carnegie Hall is limited seating, but the internet, you know, is, you know, I was doing a concert on Facebook Live a couple of days ago, and I said, you know, don't knock Facebook Live. It's the biggest concert hall in the world. It's 1.69 billion seats. It's a big concert hall. And so, you know, if you think of it that way, then it's different. And so I'm excited about the competition, even though it's going to be only online.
So just to be clear, it's the getting to the final phase will be online, but then you'll have the actual performance in person next year when the vaccine is.
So the way we're going to do it is we're going to have to pre-record the performances. Normally I would get together with the finalists in New York, and we would rehearse, and then we'd do the concert at Carnegie Hall, and then somebody would, you know, win. But instead this time, we don't have all the details, but basically the four finalists will be chosen, and then I will rehearse with them and record the piece. Mm-hmm. And then we'll go live when we go live through the Violin Channel. So, you know, then we'd have their 350,000 people and whoever else wanted to join. And we haven't figured out exactly how people will vote, and if basically it's like, you know, if for $5 you can be on the jury or something like that. Mm-hmm. Or maybe it will be free. We haven't decided yet. But you know, at Carnegie Hall, obviously there would be a ticket, and then that money, you know, it's a non-for-profit, and so that money goes back into the competition and into the prize and everything. But you know, it's going to be similar, the format, in the sense that you'll see somebody play, and then I'll do a bit of a chat with that person live, kind of like Michelle and I are doing right now. And you know, then they'll judge you, Michelle. They'll judge you on your
background. I'm sure I'm being judged now. So
they'll judge you on your background, and you definitely are winning in the background.
That's right. Right. We had a debate before this began of whether or not I should put a beautiful sunset in the background or keep the working background. So we opted for the work.
I like it. Shows character.
That's right. So does anyone else in the audience have questions? I don't want to monopolize the conversation. Julian, I guess, what's next for you?
What's next? Well, it's pretty much all downhill from here. No. I mean, the lockdown was really tough, because both kids were at home. So I'm the kind of person that, you know, wherever you put me, I'm like, oh, I have a lot of ideas, a lot of energy. I want to write pieces. I want to practice pieces. I want to write scripts. I'm just like into doing a lot of stuff. But with the kids not in school, and our daughter is 7 and our son is 2.5. So, you know, it's a great age, you know. committing suicide. It's very interactive. To speak about interactive, that's interactive. He had a meltdown the other day because they didn't want to let him crack an egg in his hand. Just to give you a, you know, baseline. But anyway, so it was difficult because there was no time to do anything. You know, we had to stay inside, and Paris apartments aren't, you know, very big. And so it was tough. But what's next is the one classical minute, mm-hmm. which we're filming whenever we have a free moment. And the competition is next, which means that I have to finish writing for violin this year. So mm-hmm. I've written the first two movements, and now I'm trying to finish writing the second, the third and the fourth movement. So I see somebody has a question there. Are your children musical, and are you encouraging them to take up an instrument? To lift an instrument. No, you know what? I'm very, very hesitant to push them at all. My daughter very often sits down at the piano, you know, especially if I have just sat down to practice. She immediately decides that this is a good moment for her. But I have not made them, you know, take lessons or anything like that. I've taught my daughter a little bit just because she was very interested in learning. But she's a very physical kid. So she really wants to just like run and play and jump. And, you know, she's learning how to read in Greek right now. So that's very strange, because normally she just wants to be, you know, very interact, very touching. She goes up to, you know, it's very funny. They always tell you, be careful with your kids. You know, strangers will come up to them and offer them things and try to take them away. It's the terror of most parents. Not with our kids. My daughter, she goes up to the people. She's going to offer them a candy and then take them away. No, it's like crazy. We were in Greece the other day. We turn around and she's sitting down and having a conversation with like this 65-year-old guy on a bench who had a dog. I think maybe it was the dog. But yeah, they're unpredictable kids, but it's amazing. You know, it's fun.
Well, they're adorable. They're very adorable children, and I'm sure they're going to be incredibly talented. Like, see you guys.
Well, we'll see.
Speaking of talents, we have one more question and then we'll wrap it up. But many of your talents have been on display today. But what is one useless talent that you have?
One useless talent I have is, I don't know. That's a very, very strange question. I think that the talents that I have, I don't think I have many talents personally, but I love to cook, but that's a very useful talent, I find. And a useless talent is perhaps being so sociable now during the lockdown. That was very useless to me. They locked me out of my Chase account the other day. And so I had to call them and then, you know, it was like 3 a.m. here. But, you know, I became friends with the lady on the
human interaction.
Her kids and my kids. And it was very weird. So yeah, I don't think that's a useless talent though. So I cannot answer that question. I do not have a good answer for that question.
Well, maybe all of your talents are just useful. So
maybe that's it.
Well, I know we're running out of time, so I do
want to do our last piece.
That's right. That's right. Say thank you so much. This has just been wonderful. And I really want to thank John Gardner and Kathy Weidman again for sponsoring this wonderful performance. I hope that everyone had a good time. To Julian's point, we do have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for someone special. If you've enjoyed Julian's amazing performance this evening, you can enjoy it again. With your own private virtual performance for your family and friends while supporting On the Figge by bidding on this private performance on our auction website. And his performances, you got an idea of it today, but his performances have been described as weaving music and anecdotes into a one-of-a-kind interactive experience, which have been called Saturday Night Live meets Carnegie Hall. I don't know how you feel about that description, but I think it's a great one.
I'm okay with the Saturday Night Live part.
I think it's very flattering and appropriate. So you can bid on our website. You can use the link that Sarah's very kindly put in the chat room. And you know, we hope that you will continue to join us for many more of the virtual events during our 15-day celebration. We have a variety of events, from an online tour of the John Deere Art Collection, a blown glass demonstration, a Caribbean cooking class, beer tasting, and much more, plus many, many auction items. So Sarah's put the links to the various places to find those things, but in the chat, and you can also support our mission by donating today. Your gift will be matched dollar for dollar, up to $5,000, thanks to the generosity of Thomas Kay and Jennifer Figge. All proceeds that we raise through the 15 days will support the Figge's art and education programs, enabling us to bring art and people together at a time when it's needed most. So go to figgeartmuseum.org and follow us on social media and continue to be part of the fun. So thank you again, and I'm now going to turn it over to Julian to close
us out. Michelle, I think we should have combined my show with the beer tasting one.
Oh my God. Where were you during the planning process?
What a missed opportunity.
No, next time.
Well, I thought that it would be fun to end with just a piece of music. So this is a bit of a very silly piece of music. You will all recognize it, I think. You probably don't know the composer. His name is Werner Thomas, and he's from Davos, Switzerland. But this is the Chicken Dance, my transcription of the Chicken Dance, which was a big hit during the lockdown with my kids. And in Italy, we call it Il Ballo del Quacqua. It's been a real pleasure getting to hang out with you in Davenport. I hope to meet you personally when this insanity ends, and give you a virtual hug for now, is the best I can do. And thanks for being here, and thanks for donating to the Figge. Good night. Thank you.